Hello again, everybody. Joel Colander here with Rock Island Auction Company, here to talk to you about some fully automatic arms that are appearing in our April 24th, 25th, 26th Premier Firearms Auction coming up, catalog for which is online right now at rockislandauction.com. We've had a quite nice selection of Class 3 and NFA items come through for this auction. So if you are a machine gun collector, if you need to buy some suppressors, if you need full autos, frankly, from any era, you are in luck. I've chosen three to highlight today, not just for their significance or how ubiquitous they are in various hemispheres, but because these three machine guns come to us courtesy the collection of one Mr. Larry Vickers. Now, if you watch firearms-related content online, and I'm guessing you do, you may know Mr. Vickers from his Vickers Tactical YouTube channel. The link we will throw up right about here. Now, if you know little of Mr. Vickers outside his YouTube channel, you may or may not be surprised to know he is a veteran of U.S. Army Delta Force. He has indeed been there and done that. In his combat experience, he has been involved in some of the most significant special operations missions of the last quarter century. Specifically, during Operation Just Cause, he participated in Operation Acid Gambit, which involved the rescue of Kurt Muse from the Modelo prison in Panama City, Panama. Since then, and since Operation Desert Storm, he has served as a tactics and marksmanship instructor for active duty special operations personnel, some of which were involved in the later capture of Saddam Hussein and the elimination of his sons Uday and Qusay Hussein. But his involvement doesn't just stop at training. He's also been involved in firearms design. He was directly involved in the design and development of the HK-416, which, if you're keeping track of our third world dictators, was used by Naval Special Forces warfare personnel to kill Osama bin Laden. Mr. Vickers has developed numerous small arms accessories. He's even developed and offered a line of Vickers tactical Glock pistols. He currently travels the country conducting combat marksmanship classes for civilians, law enforcement, and military alike. He has even found time recently to author the Vickers Guide series of firearms books, which, if you keep volumes in your office, make you look very, very smart. So now that you understand who Mr. Vickers is and his contributions to the firearm community, to the military community, the tactical community, let's cover some of the guns that he has consigned with us in the April 24th, 25th, and 26th firearms auction. To my right, a gun that perhaps needs no introduction, this is an M16. We actually have several M16s in the sale, but this is the only one manufactured by Harrington and Richardson, interestingly enough. So when Colt's production didn't meet demands in the later 1960s, the work was subcontracted out. Now, of course, you had Colt producing, you had Harrington and Richardson, and you had the High Dramatic Division of General Motors also producing M16s for the U.S. government. So it is a classic M16. All the design features you want to see, the triangular front handguard. Here we have our teardrop-shaped forward assist. And on the other side, though, what really sets it apart is we obviously don't have a rampant Colt stamped into our receiver anymore. We still have the property of U.S. government, M16A1, but here we have, in a circle logo, the lion standing on top of the H&R. Now, with Colt taking up the bulk of production, obviously versions by Harrington and Richardson and GM are quite collectible and may drive a premium even over a regular M16. We are always pleased to see M16s come through Rock Island. They're surprisingly, for being a U.S. military firearm and how much more recently they were produced than a lot of other firearms, we just don't see them as much. But that aside, let's go from one Stoner, Fremont, and Sullivan design to the next. This is a Stoner 63A. If you're not familiar with the Stoner 63A, they were designed by Stoner to be almost a completely modular, lightweight weapon system. With one receiver, he wanted this to be able to convert into six different configurations. You had a carbine conversion, a rifle, an auto rifle, a light machine gun, a medium machine gun, and then a mounted or coaxial version of the M63A. There were a couple versions that came before it developmentally. The M69W, which was kind of a funny way of him saying, like, if you flipped it upside down, it was the same thing, because a lot of configurations, when you switch it, It goes from magazine fed underneath, and when you flip it upside down, now you have belt fed configuration. So a little bit of a play on the numeration by Mr. Stoner. When we mentioned he designed it to be modular, we also mentioned he designed it to be lightweight. You can maybe tell from the fluted barrel. In some of its configurations, you're talking about maybe a 12-pound rifle, but it's not a rifle. It's also going to serve as a light machine gun. So now you have something essentially nearly the weight of an M1 Garand performing suppression duties and providing full auto fire. So huge development, and much lighter, obviously, than the M60s they were looking to replace. Unfortunately, they had several shortcomings. They were not adopted en masse. That honor would go to the FN Mini-Me, which would be adopted as the M249, a gun that was a full 4 pounds heavier than the 63A. And while we mentioned while it wasn't adopted by the Marines, due to complexity and some necessary maintenance that's required for the gun to stay operational, it was officially adopted by the Navy SEALs and saw use in Vietnam. In all, about 4,000 were made. Unfortunately, most were destroyed when the M249 was adopted. So to have a Cadillac gauge Stoner 63A in-house is quite a treat. I believe in my probably 7 years that I've been here, we've only seen one other come through. So they are indeed far and few between, not only for American U.S. military collectors, but also for just full auto enthusiasts. And last but not least, the AK-47. Only it's not just any AK-47. This is a North Korean Type 58. Now, as excited as some of you were about the North Korean Type 63 in our previous auction, this I'm definitely assuming there are some ears perking up right now. These were originally developed with some Soviet help and then some Soviet manufacturing help and putting those together, but eventually as production ramped up, the North Koreans, of course, were able to take over those responsibilities for themselves. As Mr. Vickers notes in his book, you'll see the North Korean markings, and you notice generally a more crude construction than some of these Soviet-made ones, but ultimately a rifle that's rugged and ready for service. Interesting fact, speaking of the 58 and the 63, North Korea is the only nation who made the AK variants who developed the fully automatic AK before they developed the SKS version. So they developed their Type 58 AK machine gun before 5 years before the Type 63 SKS. A little unusual as far as development goes, but both supremely collectible. Not a lot of firearms make it out of North Korea. We see them far and few between. And when you see upwards of 40,000 guns a year, that's saying something. So in addition to these machine guns, Mr. Vickers has also generally consigned with us several very high performance sniper rifles in the sale, of which we will include a link in the description below. As we've mentioned in other videos, when it comes to the selection of U.S. military arms in the April 24th, 25th, 26th Premier Firearms Auction, the selection is unbeatable. Obviously, it is not the only genre. From NFA items, both foreign and domestic, from high-end sporting arms, from big bore hunting rifles, antiques, high art antiques, Colts, Winchesters, and an immaculate collection of Smith & Wessons you don't want to miss. The April Premier Firearms Auction at rockislandauction.com.